Hi, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Susie Nicklin, and I'm the director of the literature team at the British Council. I'm based in our offices in London in Trafalgar Square. And it's the most enormous privilege for me to have travelled yesterday to Karachi with one of the most famous living British writers, Hanif Qureshi. This is Hanif's first trip back to Karachi in 25 years, and I really did feel very honoured being with him as he drove through the city and saw all the changes that had taken place here. He's been a fabulous support to the British Council Literature Department, and we've always really valued and enjoyed working with him so much over the years throughout his career. Just to give you a little bit of an idea about how the session will go, he's going to do a brief introduction. He'll be briefly introduced, then he'll do a reading, then there'll be Muniza and Hanif will talk among them between to each other, and then he'll take some questions from the audience. There will be people around with red t-shirts like that one who will have microphones, so please do wait for one of them to come to you with a mic before you ask a question. And at the end of the session, Hanif will be signing in the author's booth at the bookshop, which is to the right, out that way. So I'd love to hand over now, please, to Muniza Shamsi, one of the most distinguished writers, critics, and anthologists here in Pakistan, who's writing a book at the moment on Pakistani English literature. So I'm going to hand over to Muniza, and she'll take on from there. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Susan. It's great pleasure for me to introduce Hanif Qureshi, who is considered one of the most influential British-born writers of Asian origin and has been described as the writer who has done more than any other to alter perceptions of what it means to be British Asian. His early work foreshadows the writings of many others, ranging from Nadeem Aslam to Ayub Khan Din. The Times has named him one of the 50 greatest British writers since 1945. Playwright, screenwriter, novelist, short story writer, essayist, film director, and teacher, Hanif Qureshi was born in London in 1954, the son of a British mother and a Pakistani father, Rafiul Shah Qureshi. He was encouraged to write by his father, who belonged to a family of Pakistani English writers, ranging from journalist Umar Qureshi to poet Maki Qureshi, as most of you knew, and his cousins are out here in full force. Many of them writers, such as Nusrat Nasrullah and Shirin Haroon. Hanif read philosophy at King's College, London, and in 1921, his play Outskirts won the George Devine Award for the most promising playwright. Much of his early work, including his famous screenplay, My Beautiful Laundrette, looks at issues of ethnicity and fascism and racism, and asserts a Britain that is multicultural, not monocultural. The screenplay received an Oscar nomination, a BAFTA award, a New York Film Critics Award, all for the best screenplay, and he was the first writer of Pakistani origin to have received these honors.
Thank you. Like many Indians, my dad was small, but he was also elegant and handsome, with delicate hands and manners. And he was broad and strong too. When young, my dad had been a boxer and a fanatical chest expander. He was as proud of his chest as our next door neighbors were of their new kitchen range. Dad told me that in India, he had shaved his chest regularly so that its hair would sprout more luxuriantly in the years to come. I reckon that Dad's chest was the one area in which he'd been forward-thinking. Soon my mother, who was in the kitchen, came into the room and she saw my dad practicing for the Yoga Olympics. And she said, oh God, Haroon, all the front of you is sticking out and everyone can see. She turned to me and she hissed, you encourage him to do this. At least pull the curtains. It's not necessary, Mum, I said. There isn't another house that can see us unless they're watching through binoculars. That's exactly what they are doing, she said, watching us through binoculars. When Dad spoke, his voice came out squashed and thin. Karim, he said, read to me in a very clear voice from my special yoga book. So I ran and I fetched my dad's favorite yoga book, Yoga for Women. I squatted beside him and I declaimed, "This position, Salamba Sasana, revives and maintains a spirit of youthfulness, an asset beyond price. It's wonderful to know that you're ready to face up to life and extract from it all the real joy it has to offer." He grunted his approval at each sentence and opened his eyes, seeking out my mother, who had closed hers. I read on, "This position also prevents loss of hair and reduces any tendency to grayness." That was the coup. All grayness would be avoided. Dad stood up. "I feel better," he said. "By the way, Margaret, are you coming to Mrs. K's tonight? Come on, let's all go out as a family and enjoy ourselves." "But it isn't me that Eva K wants to see," said Mum. "She ignores me. I'm not Indian enough for her. I'm only English." "I know you're only English," said my dad. "But maybe tonight you could wear a sari." "It's a special occasion too," said Dad tonight. This was obviously what Dad had been leading up to. He waited for us to ask him about it. "What is it, Dad? What's going on tonight?" He said, "You know, they've so kindly asked me, these neighbours in Beckenham, to speak on one or two aspects of Oriental philosophy." Dad spoke quickly and then tried to hide his pride in this honour, this proof of his importance, by busily tucking his vest in. This was my opportunity. I said, "I'll come with you tonight to Eva's if you want me to. I was going to go to the chess club, but I'll force myself to miss it if you like." I said all this as innocently as a vicar, not wanting to stymie things by seeming too eager. I've discovered in life that if you're too eager, others tend to get less eager. And if you're less eager, it tends to make others more eager. So the more eager I was, the less eager I seemed. "Okay," Dad said to me, "go and get changed." It took me several months, it seemed, to get ready. I changed my entire outfit at least three times. But at 7 o'clock, I came downstairs in what I knew were the right clothes for Eva K's special evening. I wore turquoise flared trousers, a blue and white flower pattern see-through shirt, blue suede boots with Cuban heels, scarlet Indian waistcoat with gold stitching around the edges, a headband, and I washed my face in Old Spice. Dad was waiting at the door for me. When Dad saw me, he suddenly looked very agitated. My dad had been in Britain since 1950, over 20 years. And yet for 15 of those years, he'd lived in the South London suburbs. Yet he still stumbled around the place like an Indian who just got off the boat. And he asked me questions like, "Is it true that Dover is in Kent?" I sweated with embarrassment when Dad halted strangers in the street to ask directions to places that were 100 yards away in an area where he'd lived for almost two decades. But Dad's naivety made people protective, I think, and women were drawn by my dad's innocence. They wanted to put their arms around him or something, so lost and boyish did he look at times. Not that this was entirely uncontrived or even unexploited. When I was small and Dad and I sat in Lyons Corner House drinking milkshakes, Dad would send me like a messenger pigeon to women at other tables and have me announce to them, "My daddy wants to give you a little kissy." So my dad taught me to flirt with everyone I met, girls and boys alike, and I came to see charm rather than courtesy or honesty or even decency as a primary social grace. And I even came to like people, as you will see, who were callous and vicious, provided they were interesting. But I was sure my dad hadn't used his own gentle charisma to sleep with anyone but Mum while married. Now, though, I suspected that Mrs. Eva Kay, who had met Dad a year ago at a writing for pleasure class, I suspected she wanted to put her arms around my dad. Plain prurience was one of the reasons I was so keen to go to her place tonight, and embarrassment one of the reasons why Mum refused. You see, Eva Kay was forward, she was brazen, and she was wicked. I didn't recognize Eva Kay when she greeted us at the door, and for a moment I thought we'd turned up at the wrong house. The only thing Eva Kay wore was a full-length multicolored caftan, and her hair was down and out and up. She darkened her eyes with coal, so to me she looked a bit like a panda bear. When the front door was safely shut and we moved into the darkness of the hall, Eva Kay hugged my dad and she kissed him all over his face. including his lips. This was the first time I'd ever seen my father kissed with any interest. Surprise, surprise, there was no sign of Mr. K. When Eva moved, when she turned to me, she was like a kind of human crop sprayer, pumping out a plume of oriental aroma. I was trying to think if Eva K was the most sophisticated person I'd ever met, or the most pretentious, when she kissed me right on the lips, too. Then, holding me at arm's length as if I were a coat she were about to try on, she looked me all over and said, Karima Mia, you are so exotic tonight, so original. It's such a contribution. It's so you. Wow. Thank you, Mrs. Kay, I said. If I'd had more notice, I'd have got dressed up. I felt that I was being watched, and when I looked up, I saw that Charlie, her son, who was at my school in the sixth form and almost a year older, was sitting at the top of the stairs, partly concealed by the banisters. Now, Charlie was a boy upon whom nature had breathed such beauty. His nose was so straight, his cheeks so hollow, his lips such rosebuds, that people were afraid to approach Charlie. Men and boys got erections just being in the same room as him. For others, the same effect was had by being in the same country. Now Charlie lowered his head 1/32 of an inch in acknowledgement of me. Glad to see you, man, he said, coming downstairs. Charlie embraced my dad and called him by his first name. What confidence and style he had. It wasn't like this at the chess club. What was Eva Kay up to now with my dad? What was going on? She'd pushed back the furniture. The patterned armchairs and the glass-topped tables were up against the pine bookshelves. The curtains were drawn. Four middle-aged men and four middle-aged women, all white, sat cross-legged on the floor, eating peanuts, drinking wine. There was some chanting music going on that reminded me of Bach. Charlie said, don't you love Bach? I said, it's not really my bag, man. He said, fair enough. I think I've got something that's more your bag upstairs. Where's your dad? I said to him. Oh, he said he's having a nervous breakdown. Oh, I said, does that mean he's not here? Yeah, he said, he's gone into a therapy center where they allow it all to happen. They give them acid to free their minds. Wow, I said. In my family, nervous breakdowns were as exotic as New Orleans. I had no idea what a nervous breakdown actually entailed, but Charlie's dad had seemed the nervous type to me. The only time he came to our house, he sat on his own in the kitchen, crying. I'm going to stop there. Thank you.
You were actually first a playwright, then a screenwriter, and after that you were sort of established before you wrote your first novel, then you went on to short stories. I wondered, what impels your choice of genre? Do you have a preference for one or the other? And how do they, what does each offer?
I basically went where the paying worked and where the interest was. When I was 18, I went to work at a theatre called the Royal Court in West London. And I worked there as an usher, and I read plays, and I attended rehearsals by Samuel Beckett, and I met actors, actresses, and that was really, although I was at university at that time, that really was my education in culture. And I just wanted to be with where the action was, and the Royal Court was the theatre of John Osborne. It was also the theatre of Brecht, of Beckett, and so on. And it was a lively place. So what I would advise my kids is to go where the intelligent people are, go where the interest is, go where the creativity is. So I worked at the Royal Court for a bit. And then I worked at another theatre called Riverside Studios, which was also fascinating, full of people who were older than me, intelligent. And then Channel 4 started in the early 80s. And they had to commission plays from Asian and black writers. And I was the only Asian or black writer they'd ever heard of, because I'd been writing plays. So I got the writing gig at Channel 4, and I began to write, work on the screenplay of My Beautiful Laundrette, which in fact I mostly wrote at a house round the corner from here, mostly at night because I had a jet lag, so I was so desperate for entertainment, I had to write. And I wrote most of that movie there. And that was the first time, I guess, that this sort of material to do with immigration, to do with the way Britain was changing, to do with race, to do with multiculturalism, as it later became known. That was the first time that sort of material reached a much larger audience. It's a movie, and it was big in America and in South America, and particularly in Europe and France and so on. So it was that was a big change in my life and a big opportunity for me when I became at last some sort of known writer. And I had money, and then I had the opportunity to write stories, essays, and I had enough money then to buy time to write the novel which I always wanted to write, which was The Buddha of Suburbia.
Well, thank you. A lot of your work is set to draw very heavily on autobiography. And in Laundrette, you said, in my beautiful Laundrette, you said that the two boys, Johnny and Umar, kind of represented two sides of yourself. What is the relationship between autobiography and fiction, and what are the conscious and unconscious forces that impel plot and character?
I was lucky in a way in terms of my material. You have to be fortunate. You have to have good luck as a writer, as well as talent and persistence and the ability to bear large amounts of boredom. And my father, who'd come from India to be educated in Britain, who'd stayed working in Britain and remained at the Pakistan embassy. So if I wrote autobiographically, if I wrote about my father, I was also writing about something important that was changing in Britain. And my father's journey to Britain, his life in the suburbs, his interest in Oriental philosophy, his little job as a sort of local guru, all of that was not only to do with my own personal stuff, but it was also to do with what was happening in Britain. And it's really that link that you look for. There's no point writing about your mum just for the sake of it. What you've got to do is somehow link the life of your mum somehow to the lives of other people's mums and what other people are thinking about and how they're living. Most of the writers that I'd grown up reading, like Forster and Orwell and Green particularly, who I worship, had written about colonialism. I couldn't write about colonialism, but I could write about reverse colonialism, which was us coming to Britain. And this huge rise in the amount of immigration in the 50s through the 60s and 70s and so on, and the way Britain had changed, and racism, skinheads, the extreme right and so on. So I found that some of the material for my own experience I could then turn into stories about what was happening in the country. And that was the link, I think, between me and the reader. Not necessarily the relationship of my, not necessarily the relationship between me and my material, but the relationship between the reader and the material, which is the key thing.
When I was reading Buddha, I came across a dialogue which is one of the fundamental sort of issues that keep coming up with Pakistani English literature, and that is, there's a black writer, and she says to Karim, because he's looking for material, and I think she says to him, well, you shouldn't write this because, you know, it'll give a bad impression of your community, and of course he thinks that's censorship. Have you ever felt the burden of representation?
There was some of this stuff, particularly in the 80s. I remember being in New York with my beautiful Laundrette, which was a big hit in New York in about 1986, 1987. And every Sunday there used to be a demonstration against my beautiful Laundrette by something called, this was long obviously before the fatwa, by something called the Pakistan Action Committee. And they used to march up and down outside the cinema with their banners saying, "Down with Hanif Qureshi, ban this film." And occasionally they'd ring up the owner of the cinema and threaten to bomb him and blow him up as well. A pattern that, as we know, soon became established. And they used to, and I used to say to them, I used to turn up and talk to them. And I used to say to these guys, what's going on? And they'd say, well, you've written about homosexuals, haven't you? And I said, yes, I have. And they said, well, you don't seem to realize that there are no homosexuals in Pakistan at all. I said, what, not one at all? They said, no, not a single one. So you're showing us as being homosexuals, and you've got a completely the wrong picture. Having been fondled all over Southeast Asia, I had to say that this was not necessarily correct. And I I understood the arguments about representation because I thought, well, if there are not many films and stories and plays and so on about Pakistanis and you're doing the only one and they're homosexuals, I do understand their point of view. But on the other hand, you know, you're a writer. I'm not doing PR. I just have to write the stories I like to write and the stories that amuse me. And that's all I can do, and that's all that all of us as writers can do. You know, you can't write pleasant or nice characters. There's none of that in Dickens or Shakespeare. It's just not interesting. It's the monstrous characters that are fun. It's the transgressive characters that are fun.
A lot of your work, including The Buddha, Suburbia, and Black Album, and lots of it, is permeated with references to pop music and pop culture, but also to literature, to Chekhov and a host of writers. How did literature and pop music speak to you while you were growing up, and how has it changed in contemporary British culture?
Well, I grew up in the 60s. So I had an Indian stroke Pakistani father, and many of my friends were in bands. There was a group of us in the suburbs called the Bromley Contingent who later formed bands like Susie and the Banshees and so on, Billy Idol, who was a mate of mine. So I was an Indian boy living in a suburban house surrounded by these fascinating kids who later became photographers, who got involved in punk, and so on. I think what you have to try and do is write a book that contains all the stuff in it that's in your life, in your head. And in order to do that, you have to invent a new book. You know, I had to invent a book that I hadn't written before, a book, you know, in which an Indian boy is wearing velvet trousers and is wearing earrings and, you know, takes LSD. But also, you know, who has a father who's an Indian from an Indian family who now live in Pakistan. You have to find a way of putting all this stuff together. And that's the challenge and the difficulty of writing a book. You have to, as it were, invent a book, write a book that hasn't been written before. And you have to find characters who speak to you, through you, and speak for you. It's a nightmare to do. It's very, very difficult, but I guess that's why people write books.
Then you came to Pakistan when you were about 30, I think, and you went to Pune and to Madras later on. How did that first trip and all these other trips influence your writing and your perception of yourself?
I remember coming to Karachi, and I remember my dear Uncle Satu. So he said this wonderful thing to me. He said, "We're Pakistanis, of course," he said, "but you'll only ever be a Paki, won't you?" And I remember thinking, that's right. And that rather offhand remark had a big influence on me. I thought, when I went back to London, I thought, I've got to write about London, and I've got to write about England. And I thought, England's got to change to suit me. I can't change, I've got to be who I am, but England's got to change. And really, through the 70s and 80s, and particularly in the 90s, Britain began to change, become a multicultural society, so that people like me could say, you know, we're British, you know, we're not half English, we're not mongrel, it's not a question of us fitting in or not fitting in. The whole country had to change to make a place for us. So coming here for the first time and then going to India and so on made me think about how you make a society, you know, all these bits and pieces. And I have to say, it's really interesting, Britain. British people have worked really hard in terms of race. Recently, there have been a number of cases, particularly with regard to football, about racism. And the authorities in Britain are really coming down hard on racism and refusing racist language because they can see, they seem to have understood at last, that it's a terrible contamination and a real corruption of people's relationships, racism. And you just have to stamp it out in public life. So the country really has changed, and it's been a revolution. And if you go to France, and certainly if you go to Italy, you'll see that they're not half as advanced as Britain is in terms of its writing about race and thinking and speaking about race every day.
I've only really been here 24 hours, but what strikes you about Karachi after all these years?
Karachi looks much more run down now than it did last time.
It looks really rough compared to the... it seemed more charming, I remember, in recollection. Now, when you walk around it now, it looks like a city that's sort of in decay, I'm afraid to say. I'm sure you're aware of that. Someone said to me, I think one of my cousins said to me, it's like a war zone here now. I said, I can see that. So, bad luck.
One of the questions I get, because you joined both my anthologies of Pakistani English literature, and I'm often asked, did Hanif Qureshi give you permission to include his work in this Pakistani book? And I say, well, yes. And then they want to know why I wanted to include him in the first place. I mean, I have my answer. Do you have an answer to that? Not for me, but from your point of view, what is identity?
I'm very happy to be included in your book. I'm very lucky to be in there at all, so I'm grateful. Thank you. If anybody reads anything I write, I'm still extremely grateful. And if you're a writer, what you want is to be read by people. I don't know what identity is. Identity really doesn't bother me anymore. I don't really think about it. I don't think about who I am in that sense anymore. Really, an identity is a relation between you and yourself, and then between you and your family and your place. And when I decided that I wanted to be a writer, and when later on I became a writer, I felt all right after that. I thought, that's what I am, I'm a writer. When I grew up in the suburbs, people used to say to me, who are you? Where are you from? Are you a Pakistani? Are you British? Where do you belong? And I used to say, I live in that house down there. And they'd say, where do you really belong? And it gave me a sort of crisis. But later on, when I figured out I was a writer, it sort of saved me somehow, and it's who I like to be.
You turned your attention to the radicalization of young British Muslims long before anyone else. What made you explore this? How has the perceptions of Muslims how has it been changed over the years?
Well, I noticed. I was really interested in, influenced by my thinking, the fatwa against Rushdie in 89. It was a really big deal for all of us who are writers and also friends of Rushdie that this man had written this book, and then there were lots of people who wanted to kill him for doing it. And it made me think very, very hard about writing. Importance of writing, what it means. We'd taken, as it were, free speech and writing for granted. You could just do and say anything by the end of the 70s through the 80s that you wanted. By 89, after the fatwa, it was really shocking, and it made me think not only about the place of writing, the meaning of writing, and what writers could do here in Pakistan and England and around the world, but it made me think a lot about fundamentalism. And I went to various colleges near my house, and I went to some of the mosques, and I made friends with kids that I would not, I guess, normally speak to, who were so-called fundamentalists, who wanted a revolution, who were extreme Muslims. And of course, in the 70s, I'd been involved in the anti-racist movement in Britain, but that was allied to socialism, to the left. But suddenly these kids who were originally anti-racist had become what we call fundamentalists, or they were extreme Muslims. And I found this really shocking, because it occurred to me that people had come to Britain in order, as it were, to have more freedom, to reinvent themselves, to live new lives in the new country. And to find them, as it were, allying themselves to something, I don't know, some sort of a mixture of contemporary radicalism and a medieval philosophy, was very shocking to me. So I spent a lot of time talking to them. And I wrote the Black Album out of that, about a kid who's drawn towards radicalism. And later on, a film, a very good film made by Udine Prasad, called My Son the Fanatic, which is partly about a kid who becomes a radical. And this was, as you know, then it seemed very new, but I remember my uncles in Karachi in the 80s talking about the terror of radicalism and the horror of the extreme Islam and so on, which I didn't at that time take that seriously, but of course now we all take it very, very seriously. And seeing its origins in Britain was very interesting for me, and I guess it was something that was happening in something I considered to be my own community.
Thank you. I think there are a lot of people who want to ask you questions as well. I have a lot more, but I'll keep them. And we open up the floor. Any questions, please?
Is the lady over there? Okay, you go.
Hanif, when you first came here, I met you at your uncle Abu Qureshi's house. We were there, my husband and I. We were good friends of Abu. And we had a chat with you, and you said, nice country, pleasant people. You were complimentary, we were thrilled. Then you went back, and you said the harshest things about Pakistan. I have never got over that. I said, what happened to him? He was a different person here. When he went back, he said something exactly the opposite. People said, you said, horrible country, don't want to go there again, things like that. How do you explain that?
Well, if you're a writer, you write as you see, and it's your job to speak the truth as you see it. And it would be absurd for me to write a piece saying that Pakistanis or my family or whatever they're really nice people. That would be absurd. It's not the point. The point is to have a point of view about a place and to try and say interesting things. I would certainly not want to say anything that was unpleasant about anybody. That would not be interesting either. The point is to see the world as it is and to speak as you see it. And that's what you pay us writers to do. You know, when you read a book, you want to know that the writer has seen cleanly and has something to say about his experience. Nobody else?
Just one more question. This is from your books. I get the impression that you have a very low opinion of women. Why is that?
I think that's just a sort of stupid thing to say, actually.
Well, I don't say that authors always come like messiahs. I mean, for the communities they might be connecting to. But I think communities do rely a lot on authors' writings. How do you connect yourself to the communities who might be connecting to you and your work?
Which community do you mean?
Like hush-hush themes that you pick on.
Like what?
The hush-hush themes that you pick on.
Mostly
taboos, being talked about from a certain perspective in Pakistan. But people do connect to your writing on that.
I can't say that there is a community of people who read my books, because there will be people, I don't know, in Australia who would read them, or people who read them here, people who are 15 years old, people who are 60 years old. And what you call hush-hush themes, I guess, which is to do with sexuality. These are the most important subjects in people's lives. These are really crucial to how people, how they desire, how they love. I mean, the English novel is about marriage. The English novel is about passion. The English novel is about divorce. The English novel is about the future. The English novel is about children. And you pay us when you read our books to talk about the things that are most important in your life and in the reader's life. And if we didn't write about that, our books would not be worth reading, I'm afraid.
There's a question over there.
Hello. Thank you, Hanif. I have one question and one observation. Just want to understand the way you used the word term reverse colonialism. In what you had in mind, if you could elaborate that. And the second, in one of your just readings, there is a reflection of self-orientalizing, as it were. That's what I heard. I interpreted. Do you think, on the one hand, you said that identity doesn't matter, and yet there is a reflection of looking through Orient through the Orientalist perspective. How you relate to that tension, if I'm correct in understanding?
I said that identity doesn't matter. I said it didn't matter to me. I didn't think about it anymore. But I can see that people now, certainly in Britain, put together very complex identities. They might say, I'm a Muslim. They might say, I'm a woman. They might say, I'm a Pakistani. They also might say, I'm from Bradford. They might also say, I support Manchester United. They might say, I support the woman's struggle. So people are very complex, and their identities are not simple. I think the problems start when you try and simplify your identity. It's complexity that's important. And I think one of the things that novelists try and do, why books, sometimes are so long, is that there's so much complexity in there. And what we need are democratic minds. We need to live in, of course, democratic countries. But to have a democratic mind, which might be what a novel might be, is to allow ourselves to hear all the numerous voices, all the numerous identities that we have speaking within us. So the point wouldn't be, as it were, to find a final identity to say that I am this, that, or the other. The point would be to hear all these things in order to see that we are more complex than we allow ourselves to be. And it seems to me that that's where we begin to get we become more interesting as human beings. The gentleman over there was talking about what he called hush-hush themes. I think he's probably referring to something like homosexuality or sexuality and so on. But as soon as we can begin to include those in our psyche, in the way we think about ourselves, we become more complex and we have a much broader view of what a human being is and can be. And I think that's one of the things that the novel, for instance, is very, very good at doing. I know that's not an answer to your question, but it's the answer I fancy giving.
I've just read a little bit of one of your books several years ago and heard you today, and on both occasions thoroughly enjoyable. I'll make sure I read everything you've written from now on. What I'd like to ask is, as I understand from Muniza's introduction, you kind of pioneered this genre of person born to mixed parentage in a Western European country and taking on a new identity, as it were, being a writer, being a social philosopher in the bargain. Is there an evolving alliance amongst such writers, people like Mohsen Hamid might be here today, and in non-English speaking Europe as well? I mean, not official, not organized, something evolving along these lines?
The writers that are coming out of Pakistan now, like Muniza's daughter, Kamila Shamsi, Mohsen Hamid, Mohammed Hanif, Daniel Moedin, and so on, there's some fantastic writers coming out of Pakistan. You've got a big reason to be very, very proud of these writers. These writers are admired all over the world now, and it's a fantastic flourishing coming out of this strange country. And these are some of the best writers in the world, and it's an amazing achievement. The father of us all is, of course, Rushdie, who's probably the most important writer in the world, and a man of huge and symbolic value. A man who speaks for himself, but also for his time and place in India. And it's amazing that this is happening. And I partly wanted to come here because of this amazing group of young writers who are becoming so well known now. I wanted to see what sort of place is it that makes such interesting people. So there's something really creative and fantastic coming on in this country. And I also believe that there's a Pakistani filmmaker who was nominated for Best Doc for her documentary at the Oscars, which is another amazing feat. So something really fascinating is starting to move and change in this country. If you measure a country, as it were, by the level of its culture, by the intelligence of its writers and the intelligence of its artists, there's something really great going on here. And I'm glad to be here to witness it in some small way. The lady there has a question.
I'm probably going to cause a bit of aggro with my question, but having been brought up as a British-born confused Desi, was part of your writing frustration at not finding an identity or is trying to escape a labeled identity? And at which point did you become wholly British and let go of the Pakistani or subcontinental background in your mind?
I never let go. I hold on to it all. It's all there. I mean, all the pieces, one's identity through one's mother, one's identity through one's mother's family, one's identity through one's father's family, through one's uncles, and then through the whole of the society, my identification with British pop, my identity with British young people, my love of the United States in the 60s through the Vietnam War and through Jimi Hendrix and so on. I said earlier, I really answered this question, that people's identities are really complex. And the more of it, as it were, they keep going, the richer they are. So I don't think that the idea of having an identity is the idea of finally deciding and then you can say, well, that's it, thank you very much, I know who I am. I don't have to bother. The idea of an identity, as it were, is of gathering more of the world into yourself than you allowed in before. And you do that through conversation, through other people, with and conversation with yourself, through forms of self-knowledge, through reading and so on. And really through opening your mind rather than closing your mind. So the idea of identity is less interesting than seeing yourself as a human being who's growing and developing all the time. So it's never a done thing. Someone else? A lady over there?
Just wanted to know what you're working on now, what you're looking forward to working on, and what drives you? What's really driving you to be interested in that or to do that?
What drives me is fascination for my work, you know? When I get up in the morning, when I got up today, I was writing. I want to write. Most writers like writing. Most artists, you know, like doing what they do. We have a huge love and passion. That's what drives you. I have to make a living. But I'd still do the same thing if I didn't have to make a living. You know, my dear friend Stephen Frears is a film director. He gets up in the morning, he's 73, makes films. That's what he wants to do. So I'm writing a novel, I'm writing a movie, there's some stories I want to write, some essays I'm working on. So the whole thing is still going forward, and I'm fascinated by the desire to speak, I'm fascinated by the desire to write, I'm fascinated by the desire I still have to be some sort of an artist, and to do better, to work harder, to write better books, to write better sentences, to say things I haven't said before. I mean, you're lucky if you're an artist. You're doing something you really want to do, and you're really driven, as you suggest, by that. You know, I teach writing. I teach creative writing for my sins in London. You know, and if the students don't have that, if they say to you, "Can you inspire me?" You think, you know, inspire yourself. You know, it's got to be. You've got to have the passion. You've got to have the desire. You can't talk somebody else into being an artist if they don't want to be an artist. Being an artist is a real passion. It's a real love. People often sometimes talk about artists as though we have a lot of discipline. It's not really to do with discipline, actually. You do it because you want to do that more than you want to do anything else that day.
Hi, I had two questions. One, I wanted to know how the working process works for you, how you go about it. And secondly, I once saw a comment by you in an article about where you were saying how while there is now a genre of writing about multicultural Britain by black British and British Asian writers, there's very little written about multicultural Britain by white British people. And as a white British woman who has lived in Pakistan and is married to a British Pakistani, I was interested in hearing you expand on that.
What was the first question? Oh, the process. It's chaos, the process. It's very hard to describe. It's chaos. You have about three or four ideas for three or four characters. And you think, how, you know, there's this bloke and he's running a launderer and his best friend's a skinhead and then there's this and then there's that. And you spend ages trying to put all these people in the same story. And you spend ages trying to work out the proportion of the people in the story. And then you spend a lot of time working out the plot, the narrative, and, you know, whether it's too quick, too slow, too this, too that. You know, you just spend ages doing it. So the process is sort of chaotic and really boring for anybody else to have to think about, and really boring for me to do, which is working out the story, and, you know, and cutting that bit and making that bit longer. I mean, it's just, you just have to sit there for ages, and it drives you mad. And I was sitting in my room the other day, and I've been working for about 3 days on something, and I thought, if only people knew how I suffer, to try and bring them such pleasure. The boredom of writing these books. And that's what writers, you know, what it is to write. You just sit there for ages until blood comes out of your ears. The other question, I was very interested and very struck by the fact that there were many writers in Britain, including Rushdie earlier on with some of his books, who were writing about race and racism in Britain. But none of the whites ever did. They never saw it as being interesting for them, or they never wrote black or Asian characters, just as we write, you know, white or Irish or Scottish characters. Their imagination seemed very limited in terms of what they were able to address. And I thought one of the most interesting subjects in Britain is, and certainly in Europe, and indeed in the whole world today, is race, and how people divide things and cut things up in terms of race, and what we use race in order to do with other people, how we use race in order to have contempt for people or to exclude them or to think about them in certain ways. Race is the major signifier in the world today. And it's not only to do with race, to do with color or whatever, it's to do with who's in and who's out and how we think about people. So I would have thought that more writers, as it were, would use that as a signifier in terms of their writing. And I'm shocked that they aren't. That's all. That's it, really. There's a chap there.
May I? Mr. Hanif Qureshi, if I heard it right, you said that the city of Karachi is on the decay, and it's become some kind of a war zone.
I said that that's what somebody had said to me. I can't say that I can speak.
Okay, I got the impression that you had formed this kind of an impression yourself. And being an old Karachiite, with my elders having been born here many years before 1947, I would like to take this statement with a pinch of salt. And speaking on behalf of many of my other fellow Karachiites who love this city very much and wouldn't like to live anywhere else in this whole world. And at the same time, you are also glad to be here and attending the Karachi Literature Festival. A city which is supposed to be on the decay, do you think all these good things would be happening around here at the moment?
No, I think it's a fascinating mixture of how certain times in certain cities, where there are presumably real conflicts between different political views, conflicts often that are very, very violent. I mean, someone said to me the other day, they said there are more journalists murdered in Pakistan than any other country in the world, apart from Mexico, every year. And that is someone from Penn told me that. At the same time, there's some fascinating writing coming out of this place. And out of such danger comes real creativity and real culture. And how could that not absolutely fascinate you and fascinate me and want to come here to see what's going on?
Well, thank you very much. And I'm sorry, there are lots more questions, but my hands are up. I think it's your answer. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Manisha.